There are a number of joystick modifications you can do to your joystick other than changing the dust cover. You can actually change the action and the feel of the joystick. So I'll show you two things right now. How to adjust the firmness of your joystick if you're unhappy with how firm it is. And you can also adjust the action, which is how far you need to push the joystick before a micro switch is triggered. So to do either of those, you need to remove, or for this joystick, we'll disassemble the retaining ring, which I have done on this one. And then we'll also remove the micro switch plate so we get down to the bare mechanics of the joystick. To access the joystick spring, you just need to remove this retaining ring, which I've partially removed. You can remove the action plunger, and now you're left with this spring. So this is the spring that this tension of the spring will force the joystick to return to its neutral position. If you like a firmer joystick that, you know, requires more force to deviate it from its neutral position, you can do this. You can remove the spring. If you have another one, you can put two of the same type springs in here, or buy a different one of a firmer force. Or I found this spring in a junk pile. I actually cut it from a larger one. This one just fits onto the smaller shaft. And then you can replace this action plunger, put the set ring back on, and now you have a firmer joystick, which resists movement to the micro switch. Another modification you can do is I'll put the original plunger back on. I'll remove the spring just so it's a little bit easier to see assembled. So this is the action for this joystick to move to a micro switch. So you can see there is a little bit of a dead zone here, so a little movement can occur before a micro switch is actually triggered. If you don't like this, I've seen various players, professional players, for Street Fighter and other arcade fighters, have liked different variants of how the joystick feels. So what I did here is I took this part and I modeled it in Autodesk or AutoCAD Inventor. And then I 3D printed a few. So here's a comparison. And what I did is I made this outer bottom cylinder a little bit larger in diameter. So here's a few variants. This one you can see has a significant diameter increase. This one's a little bit difficult to tell with the plastic, but it also, instead of this tapered edge on the original component, I have more of a symmetrical straight 90 degree edge. So we can replace this component, or the action plunger. And you can see with this replacement, there's very little dead zone left before micro switch is triggered. And I got a little bit carried away with it. And I printed this one, which is just too large to fit in here, but it'll probably fit in other joysticks. So this is a simple modification you can do along with the spring to change the feel and firmness of your joystick. Next, we'll look at a little in-depth breakdown of the micro switch, which is the main component in many commercial arcade buttons and digital joysticks. So here we have a Japanese-style digital joystick with the 8-way plate on it. So the up, down, left, right, you can see there's a micro switch that can be pressed for every direction. And for emulators that support 8-way, the diagonals here will activate two of the micro switches or two directions, like up and left or down and right and so on. So this micro switch, most are rated for 100,000 cycles or more. That's the actual test of failure, and that's the average on the bell curve for them. But sometimes they fail or sometimes that you get one that has a factory defect. So, example, you could be using, you could install your joystick and maybe one direction does not work or one direction always triggers despite it being in the neutral position. So with this American style button, I'll remove the micro switch. It just pops out. And if you look at it, it looks like one solid piece, but upon closer inspection, you can see a seam. You can usually pry it apart. If you can't use your fingers, you can use a screwdriver, flat tip, or the blade from a utility knife. Be really careful with this, and I recommend using the non-sharpened edge to pry it apart. Once you get the two halves separated, you can remove the top completely like I have done with this one, and you can look at this action. So here's the inner workings of a micro switch, where we have the common, normally open, and normally close tabs. So as you see, as I press the micro switch, all this mechanical part is conductive. Some of it's copper, some of it's metal. And when I close, or when I press the action of the micro switch, these two contacts make a short circuit and complete the circuit. Or if you use the top and common, this is a closed circuit right now, and when pressed, it opens the circuit. So this is where, if you're having problems with your joystick or button and they're not triggering or they're constantly triggering, this is where the problem may lie. So the action right here, these two copper pads may need to be cleaned or bent back in a position that they'll trigger, or they might just need to be replaced. A lot of these components here are replaceable. They're just friction fit with the plastic. So if I press down the micro switch, I can remove this piece, and we can see what the metal pad looks like that makes the electrical connection. And these pads are pretty large because most of these micro switches are rated for, let's see, this one right here is rated for 125, 250 volts AC and 15 amps, which is why looking at this pad, it looks rather large. So again, opening your micro switch up carefully, you can replace these components, clean them with alcohol, or just bend them back bend them into a position where the action will work. And all you need to do is just press back on the other shell half. These two little slots, which are very interesting, are made for levers and tabs. This is not a real tab, I just bent one to make it, but you can get lever tabs that will increase the action or push distance of your micro switches. These are more commonly in SUSOHAP arcade joystick. You can make sure your joystick is functioning by using a multimeter. So with this multimeter, I have it set on resistance, and I also have it set so when it sees a closed contact or close to zero resistance, I'll get an audible cue. You can use your multimeter to connect to, if you have a Japanese-style arcade joystick, you need to know the pinout of this Molex connector, or you can just wire to the contacts of the individual microswitches. So that's what I'll do here. And as I trigger this, so you'll see that you can hear the multimeter sense a closed contact. Another fancy way you can do this, if you need to check multiple joysticks a lot over a short period of time, you can make a circuit that looks like this, where this is the joystick, put an LED on every contact, add 5 volts and a 1K resistor to make something that looks like this. So with this end, I can plug into the joystick, and it's powered right now. So as I trigger each micro switch, you can see that each micro switch is functioning correctly. So if you have a joystick that is one of the directions are not working, this is how you can disassemble it. So this restrictor plate you need to remove. With this Japanese style joystick, you can do that by pushing in these tabs right here, and then the restrictor plate will pop off. And this joystick breaks down to a few components. One, the microswitches are all permanently soldered to a PCB that has the connection breakout right here. And this, of course, all you need to do is the same thing. You can pop off one shell of the microswitch and carefully analyze the action here to make sure it's working. If it's not working, a few of these components can be swapped out and replaced. First, let's talk about the American style arcade button, which is what you see here. So this does not have the micro switch installed. And for basic stuff, let's talk about customization. So here's a control panel with some, plain uniform color arcade buttons that I have loosely inserted. You can do some customization with these by disassembling them. If you have the micro switch installed, you can easily remove it by popping out the higher pin and rotating it, it will pop out. To do some customization, we'll swap the two inner push cylinders, and we can do that by flipping the button upside down, depressing the button, and you can squeeze these two L-shaped levers. Push them through the inside of the button, and if you pull out, you'll pull out the inner cylinder that has a spring. Of course, you can replace the spring or double up on springs to give yourself much heavier force required to push the button. But if you do this for two buttons or more, you can essentially swap the colors. So now that we have them replaced, we can push down on this spring, squeeze the two legs together and insert them into another button. And you need to flip it upside down to make sure you can align the two legs again, and they'll pop out. And we have the color switched. And you can do this for a number of colors to get a custom look.